Thank you. The final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 12707 in the name of Emma Harper on World Asthma Day 2024. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Emma Harper to open the debate. Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to lead this important debate to recognise World Asthma Day. World Asthma Day took place yesterday, May the 7th, and marked the theme Asthma Education Empowers. I thank members who have supported my motion allowing the debate to go ahead today. I also thank Asthma and Lung UK Scotland for their briefing and for all they do with research, advice and support for persons with an asthma diagnosis and their families. Gareth Brown from Asthma and Lung UK Scotland provides the secretariat for the Lung Health Cross Party Group, which I co-convene with my colleague Alexander Stewart, MSP. Gareth does a great job and I thank him for all his work. The CPG has done work relating to asthma previously, and the input from clinicians, asthma support groups and those living with asthma is welcome. And thanks again need to go to the Minister for her active engagement with our cross-party group. One of our CPG members, Olivia Fulton, chairs a group that focuses on severe asthma, which meets online, and I'll say a wee bit more about Olivia later in my speech. As my motion indicates, World Asthma Day is organised by the Global Initiative for Asthma, a World Health Organisation collaborative founded in 1993. There's a lot of great info on the GINA website, and I would encourage people to visit the website and find out some more. Asthma is a very common long-term lung health condition, and in the UK, 5.4 million people have an asthma diagnosis. That's one in every 12 adults and one in every 11 children. In Scotland, 368,000 adults and around 71,000 children live with an asthma diagnosis. And people with asthma may have sensitive, inflamed and irritated airways. Asthma symptoms can come and go. Sometimes people may not have symptoms for weeks or months at a time. And asthma needs to be treated every day, even if you feel well, to lower your risk of symptoms exacerbating and asthma attacks. The most common symptoms of asthma are coughing, wheezing, which is a whistling sound when you breathe, breathlessness and chest tightness. Experiencing one or more of these symptoms could mean you have asthma. It's more likely to be asthma if your symptoms keep coming back, if they're worse at night, or occur when you react to a trigger, such as exercise, weather, or an allergy like pet hair or pollen. Anyone experiencing these symptoms should speak to their GP as soon as possible. Presiding Officer, how serious asthma is varies from person to person. There are different types of asthma too. Indeed, there is also an important difference between severe asthma and uncontrolled asthma. Uncontrolled asthma improves with treatment changes like steroid inhalers and good inhaler technique. But someone with severe asthma, which affects around 5% of people with asthma, can have symptoms most of the time and find them very hard to control. Poorly controlled severe asthma takes a toll on people's physical and mental health, leading to an average of 4 asthma attacks per year. People who live with severe asthma also report depression, 55%, anxiety, 66%, and 68% of people say it impacts on their work and education. Where you live also has a bearing on outcomes, as people in the poorest areas of Scotland are on average 3 times more likely to be admitted to hospital due to their asthma. However, Presiding Officer, there is a huge financial cost. The cost of treating respiratory disease in Scotland is estimated at £500 million each year, and asthma care represents 97.5 million of that spend. Flare-ups of severe asthma can result in patients presenting in the most costliest part of the healthcare system, accident and emergency. Data suggests that people with severe asthma are roughly attending A&E 4 times more than people with non-severe asthma. This situation can improve. I mentioned Olivia Fulton earlier. Olivia is a great example of how improvement in severe asthma care can be achieved. She had serious challenges with her severe asthma, but thanks to proper care and treatment, she's now playing for Scotland's women's wheelchair rugby team. Asthma education has certainly empowered Olivia. Presiding officer, since 2013, Asthma and Lung UK Scotland have surveyed people with asthma and earlier this year launched their Life with a Lung Condition survey for the second time. The survey has highlighted that 24% of Scots received all three recommended aspects of asthma care: an annual review of their asthma care and treatment, a check-up of their inhaler technique, and a written asthma action plan. In particular, 75% of those surveyed said they received an annual review, 50 said their inhaler technique was checked, and 40% received a written asthma plan. So I would therefore welcome an update from the Minister regarding what further steps the Scottish Government could take to increase awareness of asthma education in Scotland so that people know what their entitlements are empowered to press for them. Presiding officer, the Scottish Government launched the Respiratory Care Action Plan in 2021 to 2026. The RCAP sets out a vision for driving improvement in the prevention, diagnosis, care, treatment and support of people living with respiratory conditions in Scotland. One of the aspects of the plan is that the pillars of asthma care be available to everyone. So I would welcome an update from the Minister on the implementation of the RCAP. Presiding officer, I want to touch on the link between asthma and inequality. We know that people from the most deprived areas of Scotland are much more likely to receive an asthma diagnosis. Managing a variable lifelong condition with complex treatments like inhalers is difficult. Managing asthma while juggling multiple jobs, family responsibilities and financial pressures is even harder. I welcome that the Scottish Government does have a commitment to tackling health inequalities, but it is important to ensure that good quality housing, sound state welfare support and good air quality are key components of achieving health equality. In particular, in relation to air quality, 57% of those living with asthma in Scotland say air quality makes them feel more breathless. Presiding officer, in closing, I want to make one final point: the importance of working across countries to learn and experience and to ensure good practice. The International Coalition of Respiratory Nurses, which I'm a member of, as I'm still a registered nurse myself, the ICRN was created in 2021. And the ICRN is a global network of advanced respiratory nurse practitioners with the aim to work together to improve care for people living with lung conditions and help educate and empower patients. So I support this year's theme, Education Empowers. Educating people does empower people to have improved care and consequently healthier outcomes. So again, I welcome this debate today and I look forward to colleagues' contributions. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Harper. I now call Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Alexander Stewart. Ms Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First of all, I'd like to congratulate Emma Harper for securing this member's debate this evening for World Asthma Day. Asthma is a chronic respiratory disease which affects over 250 million folk around the world. In Scotland, around 368,000 folk are diagnosed as suffering from asthma, including over 72,000 children. And there will be many more folk out there without a diagnosis at this point. Presiding officer, I don't think many colleagues will be surprised to hear that I am one of that 250 million, especially those who noticed me catching my breath when trying to ask a general question a few weeks ago. It's not always easy to be wheezy. I remember when I first went to the doctors and was diagnosed as borderline asthmatic, borderline COPD. I remember they were unable to tell me which condition it was. I remember being given three different inhalers, one for asthma symptoms, one for COPD symptoms, and a blue inhaler for if and when I needed it. It's a pity I hadn't carried it with me the day I needed it in chamber. There was a fair bit of trial and error to find what worked for me, and I know that I am not alone in this kind of experience. What works best for me isn't just inhalers. It's what I don't puff anymore that also made a real difference. I quit smoking over 4 years ago after being a smoker for nearly four decades of my life before that, and I feel that that has made a huge difference to my health. Even then, with trying to be healthier and with my inhalers, living with asthma can still be challenging. But the more I learn about asthma, the easier it gets. Education can empower folk to manage their conditions and to go about their lives as they wish. A few of the things I think are helpful to know are what asthma is and what is happening to your lungs. What are your symptoms of asthma? How to manage your symptoms? How to recognise if your symptoms are getting worse? And what can be a trigger for your asthma? For example, pets, perfume or deodorant, and how to avoid these. Presiding Officer, that's not an invitation for anyone to stop wearing deodorant. As with many other things in this Parliament, there is a balance to be struck. Finally, whether you're asthmatic or not, the most important things I feel folks should know are how to recognise an asthma attack and what to do about it. The main symptoms of an asthma attack are if your asthma symptoms, coughing, breathlessness, wheezing or tight chest, are getting worse, if your inhaler is not helping, if you're too breathless to speak, eat or sleep, or if your breathing is getting faster and it feels like you cannot catch your breath, if your peak flow score is lower than normal. For children, they may also complain of a tummy or a chest ache. And once you've recognised an asthma attack, here's what to do. Firstly, sit up straight and try to keep calm. And I realise that this is easier said than done. Take a puff of your inhaler, and that's usually your blue one, every 30 to 60 seconds, up to 10 puffs. If you feel worse at any point, or if you don't feel any better after 10 puffs, then dial 999 immediately for an ambulance. I'll conclude my remarks with that life-saving advice and congratulate my friend Emma Harper again on securing this important debate tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Dunbar. I now call Alexander Stewart to be followed by Jackie Bailey. Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be making this contribution, and I'd like to thank my fellow member and a co-convener with me on the cross-party group for Lung Health, Emma Harper, for securing the business this evening. Back in February this year, I lodged a parliamentary motion entitled People with Uncontrolled Asthma to highlight the issue known as severe asthma. Thereafter, in February, I was very pleased to have sponsored an exhibition within the members' lobby entitled Better Lives for People with Uncontrolled Asthma. This was specifically there for members of staff and members of parliament to find out more about severe asthma and how it's involved and what takes place. It is a serious public health challenge in Scotland, and we know it also is classified as disability under the Equalities Act of 2010. Adverse implications with reference to severe asthma can have a significant strain on our healthcare system, and we already know that asthma is the most common respiratory disease in Scotland, affecting about 17% of adults. However, as the whole idea of looking at asthma, 4% of the population were even high diagnosis, and that's really quite difficult sometimes to manage, and we've learned within the cross-party group about all the things that can support and how people can identify and be supported with that. Indeed, Asthma and Lung UK estimate that Scotland is one of the highest prevalences of severe asthma in the United Kingdom. Poorly controlled services and poorly attitude in people's mental and physical ability are challenged, and we know that leads to about an average of 4 asthma attacks per year. Well over half the people living with the asthma have depression or anxiety that leads them on to other problems within their health and their well-being, and about 70% of patients report that the condition impacts severely on their work or their education. And key opportunities to improve patient outcomes for severe asthma is to improve the pathways towards acute diagnosis. And we've talked about diagnosis in the past, about how the delay and referrals and specialist clinics and undertaking patient assessment leads to all of that, Presiding Officer, and we need to make sure that we deal with that. And I welcome the fact that this year the World Asthma Day theme is Asthma Education Empowers, because I think that does tell us a lot about what we can do when we're talking about acute diagnosis and how we can treat that. For some patients, it may mean the start of a new medicine known as the biologics, and these medicines transform lives, but we are only finding that only 1 in 5 people are receiving these therapies here in Scotland, and that needs to be looked at and talked about how we can access more, because access to treatment will save lives, Presiding Officer. Absolutely.
Emma Harper.
I thank Alexander Stewart for giving way. We've talked at our cross-party group about how pulmonary rehab helps chronic obstructive pulmonary disease and singing. Does he agree that PR can help and singing can help folk with asthma as well.
Alexander Stewart.
Emma, for that intervention. Without question, the whole idea of working the lungs and doing things, and as you know, I do a little bit of singing myself, but I don't have the asthma, and I know how that helps me.
Is Mr. Stewart about to burst into song?
I know, exactly. But I'll not do the singing to this evening. You can come to the choir and you can hear me some other time. But as I've said already, it's all about trying to ensure that we highlight and the access that we have across Scotland. And it's very important that access that we have for clinicians and experts is looked at. So I look forward to hearing what the Minister may say, because we know that there needs to be a much more equal access to advanced therapies to inform and make sure, because the severe asthma is there and we must manage it. So in conclusion, I hope that the Minister will manage to, in her summing up, talk about where we are when it comes to the Respiratory Care Action Plan and how that's progressing, pledged to address the mis- and underdiagnosing that we know is taking place, implement the clear national action once for Scotland's products, because we know that there's not the same disparity across, establish nationally agreed service asthma referral pathways and promote collaboration between primary and secondary care, and finally agree a collaboration between partners, including patients, advisory groups, as well as the third sector. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. I now call Jackie Bailey to be followed by Carol Walken. Ms. Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and let me start by thanking Emma Harper for securing this debate to mark World Asthma Day 2024. And can I also say to Jackie Dunbar, well done. Yeah. Keep going. Okay? I actually gave up 22 years ago and have never looked back, so I would encourage you to keep at it. As Emma Harper and indeed Alexander Stewart both said, the theme for this year is Asthma Education Empowers. And that's important because knowledge around accessing good and timely treatment can be life-changing for those living with asthma. Asthma and Lung UK's 2024 survey revealed that basic asthma care levels are continuing to fall in Scotland, with only 24% of sufferers receiving the three basic provisions of asthma care. Data also shows that in Scotland there are significantly low levels of uptake of specialist treatments like biologics for those who may be eligible. So there is a postcode lottery across Scotland, and despite its own challenges, it's interesting to note that NHS England currently leads Scotland with a 17 to 21% higher uptake. So there's something we could learn from that. Clearly there are issues in the levels of education and knowledge about what services are available in Scotland, both in specialist treatments and in basic asthma care. But the problem is not with public knowledge alone. Asthma and Lung UK report concerns that the Scottish Government don't accurately collect and report the correct number of people living with respiratory conditions, an issue that anybody with an interest in long COVID will be familiar with. And this matters, because poor data collection leads to poorer treatment options and ultimately poorer patient outcomes, and so it needs to be addressed. Concerns have also been raised by patients around a lack of awareness in primary care, which leads to delay in specialist referrals to clinics for patient-centred assessment and to gain an accurate diagnosis. So by ensuring that GPs are properly supported and have time to undertake opportunities to expand their knowledge and education on subjects like asthma, then the more we can make sure that patients are signposted and treated before their symptoms worsen or they end up in hospital. The survey further showed that only 40% of people who had been hospitalised with asthma were getting the follow-up care that they need within 2 days of leaving hospital. And that's despite current SIGN guidance stating that follow-up care is required to make sure symptoms then remain under control. The result of that is around 1 in 6 people who receive emergency care for an asthma attack need hospital care again within 2 weeks. So there's a logic to us getting that prevention right. We know the NHS is already under immense pressure. The lack of that basic follow-up care exacerbates this problem. Patients and health professionals need support from the Scottish Government if asthma education is actually to empower them. They need better data collection action in primary care to improve diagnostic tools and public health campaigns that can provide up-to-date information about treatment. Scotland also needs the timely implementation of the Respiratory Care Action Plan's severe asthma recommendations, the creation of clear national once for Scotland protocols for severe asthma, and indeed the establishment of nationally agreed severe asthma referral pathways, because that will promote collaboration between primary and specialised care. And in concluding, Presiding Officer, without action to address these issues, asthma will continue to be a significant public health challenge in Scotland that causes pain, it causes discomfort, and ultimately it places a strain on the NHS that is avoidable. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Bailey. And I call Cara Mochan, who will be the last speaker before I ask the Minister to respond. Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank Emma Harper for bringing this important debate to the Chamber? And can I add that I recognise the knowledge and skills that the Member has in this area and praise the ongoing work that the Member is committed to within the Parliament and beyond. I've heard her speak many times about it, so it's much appreciated. Like my colleague Jackie Bailey, Scottish Labour would like to welcome the World Asthma Day 2024, supported by the World Health Organisation, which took place yesterday, and recognise this year's theme of asthma education empowers. The prevalence of asthma in Scotland, we've heard, is around 368,000, with 71,000 of those being children. But an important point raised by Asthma and Lung UK and other members is the collection and recording of this information across health boards and the Scottish Government. We do not currently have an accurate method for collection or an agreed reporting system. And given that the Royal College of Physicians report found that two-thirds of asthma-related deaths could be preventable, I would ask the Minister if there is something that the government, Scottish Government are looking at in this, and perhaps she'd say something in her closing remarks. Medical advisers and those professionals who work in the field have identified key risk factors, as other members have mentioned, in managing the condition. And this includes overuse of relief inhalers, underuse of preventer inhalers, and any recent emergency hospital visits with no follow-up give risk. And this gives us a real great insight into the reasons for the theme this year around education empowers people. It tells us that teaching people with asthma about their condition is very important, and when they learn about asthma, they can manage their symptoms better. And that helps the patient, the doctors and the NHS as well. On researching for the debate, it became clear that we do need to have a strong will and commitment from government to prioritise this lifelong condition. Recent Asthma and Lung UK research showed that many Scots with asthma are falling short of those basic care guidelines. We know there's pressure on the NHS staff, so I would ask the Minister to address how she believes the Government can help to reverse that pressure on staff and offer asthma sufferers some hope that the outcomes from the condition can change. We've heard that there's three things: an annual review, inhaler technique check, and a written action plan. And the research shows that only 24% of Scots received all three, 25% received one, and 17% reported receiving none of the provision. So it is an important matter, and I know that the Minister will consider it to be an important matter. So I think we all agree every person with an asthma diagnosis should be offered all three elements. They should know that that is what their basic treatment plan and entitlement is. So in my final minute, I'd ask the Minister to update us on the plan, the care action plan, as others have asked to, and point to some specific points of action that she feels the Government is undertaking so that people with asthma do feel there are moves and improvements for their care. And can I just once again thank Emma Harper for the debate, and to all the members who contributed this evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. And I now call on Jenny Minto to respond on behalf of the Scottish Government. Around 7 minutes or so, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too would like to thank Emma Harper for lodging this important motion and welcome the opportunity to respond on behalf of the Scottish Government this evening. I'd also like to put on record my thanks to those supporting people living with asthma in Scotland, including our NHS and third sector organisations such as Asthma Lung UK. And I'd also like to thank the sterling work that Emma Harper and Alexander Stewart do within the CPG. I have interacted with them and happy to do so again if I'm still in this role. Carol Mockin, you're absolutely right. Asthma is something that is important to me. Both my father and brother had asthma. And as Jackie Dunbar was commenting on, it was so important. Any time we went out, we had to make sure we had the inhalers packed appropriately. Thank you, too, for Emma Harper for outlining the symptoms. World Asthma Day allows us the time to reflect on the progress made in respiratory care as well as the challenges we face. We know that care and treatment for conditions like asthma is not always where it needs to be, but we continue to work collaboratively across our whole system to tackle this. The Scottish Government is committed to improving services across the country to meet the needs through the implementation of a Respiratory Care Action Plan. The plan sets out key priority areas for driving improvement in the prevention, diagnosis, care, treatment and support for people living with a range of respiratory conditions. As well as this national plan, there is also significant work happening across wider health and social care landscape. The Centre for Sustainable Delivery supports professionals from across Scotland to come together and share best practice, while also working towards consistent, once-for-Scotland pathways in respiratory services. A priority within the current work plan of this respiratory speciality delivery group is developing a Once for Scotland asthma pathway. The aim of this group is to design a national pathway in partnership with clinicians and, importantly, those living with asthma. A major milestone in asthma care this year has been the publication of the Quality Prescribing Guide for Improvement 2024-27. This document aims to keep people at the centre of their treatment and respiratory disease management and promote safe, evidence-based, sustainable prescribing with regular reviews of medications. The guide will support clinicians across the multidisciplinary team and people with respiratory conditions and shared decision-making. It offers practical advice and options for tailoring care to the needs and preferences of individuals. Alongside the guide, a suite of national therapeutic indicators have been developed with Public Health Scotland. These indicators will allow clinicians to identify people most in need of a review. Primary care teams will be able to drill down to cluster and practice level data and can benchmark across Scotland, driving consistency in care. I think it's important to mention the point that Jackie Bailey and Carol Mockin made about the importance of data, and we are currently working with Asthma Lung UK and other key partners to commission a full national audit programme for respiratory conditions. The prescribing guide also has a focus on net zero. Many people with asthma may be surprised to learn that the environmental impact of inhalers used for treating asthma and COPD is equivalent to around 80,000 tonnes of CO2 a year. That is more than the emissions from the entire NHS fleet and full NHS waste combined. We want to ensure patients and their prescribing clinicians are equipped with facts to enable them to make choices. We also understand that for those living with lung conditions like asthma, environmental factors play a huge role in their day-to-day life. Our vision for Scotland is to have the cleanest air in Europe, and we're committed to protecting the public from the effects of poor quality air as quickly as possible. The introduction of low-emission zones in our four largest cities in 2022 is a key initiative in further improving urban air quality. And I'd also like to congratulate both Jackie Bailey and Jackie Dunbar for their smoking cessation. I was commenting to a friend that I can remember being in primary school and getting the no smoking lesson, and one of my friends went back to his parents' house where his father smoked and stuck stickers all the way up the stairway. They got ripped off, but the marks were still there. He actually now has stopped smoking, which is great. A long time going, but you did it. And as a government, we also remain committed to a tobacco-free Scotland by 2034, and the UK-wide tobacco and vapes bill will help us to achieve our ambitious target. Scotland has a range of world-leading tobacco control measures and smoking rates continue to decline. Our tobacco and vaping framework, launched on the 22nd of November last year, sets out our roadmap to 2034 and outlines decisive action to ensure we hit our goal, including work on the tobacco and vapes bill. This suite of preventative measures will help people to better manage their condition, but also support us to prevent respiratory disease in future generations. And I agree with everyone that has talked about the appropriateness of the theme of this year's World Asthma Day, as asthma education empowers. We, as Carol Mockin said, understand the benefits empowering people with asthma with the appropriate education to manage their disease and to recognise when to seek medical help. We work with many third sector partners who provide invaluable support to those living with lung disease. And I'm not going to start singing, but I spent an amazing couple of hours with the Chain Gang in Leith, singing for lung health, who Emma introduced me to. And all I can say is you wouldn't want me to sing, but it was great. And speaking
can I just say, Minister, as long as it would be clear for the official record, you know, please don't.
I won't. but it was amazing. I thought you were telling me my 7 minutes was up there, presiding officer. At that, it was clear, actually, the improvement that it was giving people to think about breathing through their entire lungs, and also just actually the peer support that they were giving each other as well. So during 2023-24, over 600 nurses accessed training modules, which is part of our respiratory care action plan to build on the knowledge and skills within the NHS workforce. Another positive development has been the delivery of guidance for children living with asthma transitioning into adult services. We know that this is a particularly challenging time for young people and their families and carers, and that not all areas of Scotland offer transition services. Guidance was developed by a group of asthma specialists in partnership with the third sector and those that have first-hand experience of a good transition. Presiding Officer, I'd like to close by reiterating this government's commitment to ensuring that everyone living with asthma in Scotland receives the best possible care and support. And as we move into 2024, we know there is still a way to go in respiratory care. And the only way we will improve is by understanding the needs of those living with the condition. My thanks again go to all the members who have contributed to this important debate today, and most importantly to those working across health and social care to deliver these commitments. Thanks.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.